money.
That time, as always, please everyone mute yourself out at this time. Also, be sure to get a pen and a paper ready to take notes and prepare your hearts and your minds to receive the Holy Spirit. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us. This is day two of our Bible study. So it's so good to see everyone this morning. Again, make sure you have your pen and your paper ready to take notes and prepare your hearts to receive from the Holy Spirit. We'll be starting in just a few minutes with our prayer. So again, thank you so much for joining.
All right, so let's go to the Father in prayer. Father, we just come before you today, just thanking you for your goodness and for your love. We thank you for waking us up this morning. We do not take that for granted. We thank you for waking us up in our right mind, for giving us energy, for giving us the desire to meet you today here on Arise, to meet you on your holy mountain. Father, we thank you for calling us out of darkness into your marvelous light and giving us one more day to live for you and glorify your name. We thank you for what you're going to do on this call for all those that are coming. Father, for all those that will watch this Bible study today, we just thank you that you would implant your word into our heart, that you would renew our minds and transform our lives. We give you the glory, honor, and praise for what you're going to do, for what you're doing, and for what you've already done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. So we are getting ready to get started. We have questions. If you have a question, we have that question and comment period immediately after Pastor Stephen finishes today's Bible study portion of the call. So as the Bible study is going on, if you have questions or comments, please feel free to chat it right there in the chat. Feel free to post your questions and send them directly to Pastor Stevens. We want to hear from you. So every question is a good question. You are now on the Arise, our daily 8 a.m. online Bible study. Are you excited this morning? I'm so excited this morning. It's so good to see those beautiful faces this so early this morning. So thank you so much for coming on for this Bible study. We commit to Arise daily, to seek God's face and not just his hand, to read, to study, and know God's word, to share our daily experience with everyone that we meet. And last but not least, to write a list. Contact everyone you know and invite them to come and join us on the Arise family call tomorrow morning. So we want you to do that for us today. All right, it's about that time. We want to go ahead and get started this morning. I'm so excited to hear what Pastor Stephen had for us this morning. Without further ado, I would like to introduce our friend, our big brother in Christ, the pastor of the call and the chief servant to Arise family, Pastor Stephen Walker.
All right. Good morning. Good morning, Arise family. Good morning. I just want to say I love each and every one of you. I'm so thankful that God has brought you into my life and that God is doing a new thing in our hearts and that we're joining together on the Bible study today. We're so glad you're here. And I just want to make sure that you guys know that this could not have happened without the Arise core team. Thank God for you guys. You are amazing. Thank you for your prayers. And thank you for you guys who are our first time guests here on Arise. We pray that God would move in your heart and give you the wisdom you need today to live your life according to his will. And I'm just going to do a quick recap for those who weren't here yesterday. Yesterday we covered Matthew 22:14, which states, "For many are called, but few are chosen." And we established that God has called you and I, and he wants to answer our heart's prayer. He wants us to come close to him. And he's calling us here on the Zoom call, too. Every morning as we show up, we're showing up for God, and we're here to hear his voice. So we're glad that you're here. And we want you to let you know that you are the called and the chosen. He called you and he has chosen you. I also want you to know that we looked yesterday at God speaking to Moses. And I'm going to pull this up real quick so you guys can see this that weren't here yesterday. We looked at how God used Moses to show us how he operates in the earth when he needs his will done. He uses us to do that. And so yesterday we looked at how God called Moses to his holy mountain. He called Moses and he called him in Exodus 3:1, he says, now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. We know that when he got there, that God spoke to him through the burning bush. God spoke to him through the burning bush and he gave him instructions, the Ten Commandments for his people. And God will work miracles through you as you show up and you hear from God and you allow him to speak his will into your life. As long as you're willing and obedient, you will be able to do God's will and he'll be with you the whole time you do it and you'll see his wonders. And that's the beautiful thing about being in the family of God, that we know we serve the true and living God, not a statue and, you know, not something that man made with their hands, but we know that we serve the true and living God. We covered that part yesterday and we discussed that God is calling you up higher and he wants you to arise and wake up early each day to meet with him on his holy mountain. I mean, think about it. He has blessings in store for you and he wants you to press in continually, being diligently, seeking him daily, which you are doing now. We looked at 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, where it says, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. That's what we want to happen in our life. And we looked at how God blessed Solomon. How does God use us on the earth? And you can see an example through Solomon, David's firstborn son. We looked at how he thinks about him daily and he plans blessings for his life, which you can see in Jeremiah 29:11 through 12, which says, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. What a beautiful thing to know that God has good plans for our life. Amen. God has plans for our life. He has things that he wants to get to us. He wants to speak to us and speak through us to other people. And we need to be open to that. So today we're going to look at God's plan for saving us from sin. God's plan for saving us from sin. So if you have your notes and you're taking notes, make sure you write this down. And which goes all the way back to Abraham in the Bible, who the Bible says is the father of our faith. And that's important. All right, so let's continue our journey up the mountain of God, and we'll start today by looking into God's word in Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, and we're going to talk about how faith brings righteousness. But let me first give you a little backdrop and a backstory to the Galatians 3 to give you the proper context, right? So Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, is speaking to new Christian converts that lived in Galatia. That's why he calls them Galatians. They were alive during the time that Jesus walked the earth, and Paul shared with them the gospel and the crucifixion of Jesus. And if you think about it, if Paul, the apostle of God, was speaking to you directly and you were hearing the gospel and the story of Jesus, you know that it's true. You know, you would know that it's true and you would follow that. And they had repented, they believed in Jesus, and they had received the Holy Spirit into their life. So that conditionally, that's exactly what you want to do. You want to repent, receive Jesus, and then walk according to the Holy Spirit and the power that he gives you. But even with all of that, some of the new Christian converts were beginning to turn back to their old life. They were turning their back on Jesus and they're going back to their old life and their old ways of thinking and living, which led them back into sin. And this is why Paul is addressing them in Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. So we're going to pick it up here. And what I'll do is let me bring this up so you guys can see this. So we'll be on the same page. I'm going to go ahead and bring up my notes so you can see it. So here we go. Make sure you write down any question that you have as well, so that we can answer those immediately after I finish here with the study. All right, so here we go. Oh, you foolish and thoughtless and superficial Galatians. I mean, you can tell Paul is not happy. Who has bewitched you? Now I'm in the Amplified, okay? It's going to give us a little bit more. Who has bewitched you that you would act like this? To whom, right before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified in the gospel message. This is all I want to ask of you. Did you receive the Holy Spirit as the result of obeying the requirements of the law? Or was it the result of hearing the message of salvation and with faith believing it? Are you so foolish and senseless, having begun your new life by faith with the Spirit, are you now being perfected and reaching spiritual maturity by the flesh? That is, by your own works and efforts to keep the law. Have you suffered so many things and experienced so much all for nothing? If indeed it was all for nothing, so then does he who supplies you with his marvelous Holy Spirit and works miracles among you, do it as a result of the works of the law which you perform, or because you believe confidently in the message which you heard with faith? All right, so what Paul is doing here is Paul is really trying to get them to understand something, that the work that was done in them was a spiritual work, and it was by the power of the Holy Spirit and through faith in Jesus Christ. But all of a sudden, and we saw with Moses, God gave Moses the law. And we saw with Moses that a lot of people who were in Galatia, the Galatians, decided to go back to serving the law instead of willingly serving Christ by the Holy Spirit. They started to thinking if they were religious, if they could be more religious, they would somehow please God. But the law actually reveals sin, and sin brings death. And so what Paul is saying is you're putting yourself back under the bondage of death. And how do we do that in our life? We'll go through religious acts. We'll show up for church. You know, we give our tithes and our offerings. You know, we're very mechanical. But we have to serve God in spirit and in truth. And that's what Paul is saying. We cannot go back to our old ways of being religious. We have to make sure that we maintain relationship with Christ. And that's only can be done by the Holy Spirit. And so we're going to look deeper into that today, because when you disconnect from the Holy Spirit, you disconnect from the grace and mercy of God. When you disconnect from the Holy Spirit, you disconnect from the power of God to move in your life. And that's what Paul was warning them about. So we're going to look at Galatians chapter 3, verse 6 and 9, and I'm going to actually pull that up on a different slide. And so what we'll do is, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look, and we're going to go a little bit deeper. I'll pull this up on the, let me put it over here. Here we go. We're going to go to Galatians. Here we go. Right there. Bam. All right. So I'm going to pull up big screen so everybody can see it. All right. So it says, just as Abraham believed God, Abraham, the father of our faith, right? Believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, as conformity to God's will and purpose, so it is with you also. That's us. I'm going to read it again. Just as Abraham believed God, we believe God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, as conformity to God's will and purpose, so it is with you also. That's us. So understand that it is the people who live by faith with confidence in the power and goodness of God who are the true sons of Abraham. The scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, and we are the Gentiles, we're not Jewish, we're the Gentiles, justify the Gentiles by faith, proclaim the good news of the Savior to Abraham in advance with the promise, saying, in you shall all nations be blessed. So then those who are people of faith, whether Jew or Gentile, are blessed and favored by God, and declared free of the guilt of sin and its penalty, and placed in right standing with him, along with Abraham the believer. All right, so we go all the way back to Abraham, and we see God establish something by his faith in God. It was counted to him as righteousness. And in him, God said, all nations will be blessed. And that's us. We're the Gentiles. And we could see in verse 8, the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith. That's us. Proclaim the good news of the Savior to Abraham in advance with the promise. So God was telling Abraham about Christ coming. When that happened, when the story happened with him and his son on the mountain, you guys know that part of the story. But God was saying that I'm going to send my son, and he will fulfill all things and restore all people unto myself. So that's a beautiful thing to know, that Abraham is the father of faith. And we know the Bible says that we serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so there's a covenant there that extends all the way out to us, and it's us. And even though we're not Jewish and we're not from the line of Abraham, spiritually we have been grafted in, and we are a part of God's elect and God's chosen to receive his promise of the good news that Jesus was coming to save us from our sins. So that's what we got to understand today, that, you know, when it comes to our faith, there's a couple things that we on a daily basis don't really even think about, that this is an inheritance that we have. This gift that we have that is given by God was given way back in Abraham as a part of his promise. And Jesus is the culmination of that story, right? So we want to move on and we want to understand that verse 10, we're going to go to verse 10. For all who depend on the law, seeking justification and salvation by obedience to the law, you know what? I'm going to pull it up. I just got to kind of check in my spirit that I should be sharing my notes on the screen. So I'm just going to be obedient. Verse 10, for all who depend on the law, seeking justification and salvation by obedience to the law and the observance of the rituals are under a curse. Look at that. Under a curse, anyone who calls himself a follower of God, a believer in God or of Christ, but decides that they want to, they are going to live their life in a way that is ritualistic and legalistic, they are under literally a curse, it says. For it is written, cursed, condemned, and destruction is everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law, so as to practice them. That means if they miss one part of the law, that they're condemned. Now it is clear that no one is justified, that is, declared free of the guilt of sin and its penalty and placed in right standing before God by the law. For the righteous, that's us, the just, the upright, shall live by, what does it say? Faith. Say faith. Faith. This is our, I mean, everything that we, our whole foundation is built on faith, right? So it doesn't matter what the past is. It doesn't matter how you were in church before. You have to know that now the law condemns and faith frees us. Verse 12, but the law does not rest on or require faith. It has nothing to do with faith. But instead, the law says, he who practices them, the things prescribed by the law, shall live by them instead of faith. And That does not work anymore. And if we look at the way Christ purchased our freedom. Now look at this. This is verse 13. Christ purchased our freedom and redeemed us. Think about redemption. I mean, we rarely think about the fact that we sin to a point where God has to redeem us, recover us from our own sin. But that's what God did. He redeemed us, right? From the curse of the law and his condemnation by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs crucified on a tree, a cross, in order that in Christ Jesus, the blessing of Abraham might also come to the Gentiles, that's us, so that we would all receive the realization of the promise of the Holy Spirit through faith. Now look, you rarely hear this taught in churches. They will tell you, you know, believe on Jesus, make him your Lord and Savior. You know, we got to worship God. He's a holy God. But then they neglect this last part. I'm going to read verse 14 again. In order, Christ got crucified to save us from sin, in order that in Christ Jesus, the blessing of Abraham might also come to the Gentiles. Look at this. This is the process. So that we would all receive the realization of the promise of the Holy Spirit through faith. The church today is absent of the power of the Holy Spirit. In Hebrew, it's Ruach HaKodesh. Their absence of the power of the Ruach HaKodesh, the precious Holy Spirit of God. And because of that, because they aren't walking in the Spirit, because they aren't teaching their people to obey God in spirit and in truth, because the Holy Spirit is not a reality in the life of the believer, we are walking absence of the power of God. Now, it doesn't mean that when you have the Holy Spirit that you will not sin. That's not what it means. What it means that if you sin, you won't stay in sin, because the Holy Spirit will convict you of that sin and you will repent and turn and come back to God. God is faithful and just to cleanse us of all unrighteousness, right? So we have to know that it is in the Holy Spirit now, especially in our life, that we have to lean on and depend on. And if we don't have an increased relationship with him, today is the day where we start crying out, Holy Spirit, please make yourself real in me and begin flowing with the Holy Spirit. Now, the law, this is the intent of the law. Goes on to verse 15, brothers and sisters, I speak in terms of human relations, even though a last will and testament is just a human covenant, yet when it has been signed and made legally binding, no one sets it aside or adds to it, modifying it in some way. Now the promises in the covenants were decreed to Abraham and to his seed. God does not say, and this is important, and to seeds, which is the descendants and the heirs, as if referring to many persons, but as to one, and to your seed is what he said, who is none other than Christ. This is what I mean. The law, which came into existence 430 years later, right? From Abraham to Christ, 430 years later, after the covenant concerning the Messiah, does not and cannot invalidate the covenant previously established by God so as to abolish the promise. For if the inheritance of what was promised is based on observing the law, as these false teachers claim, is no longer based on a promise. However, God granted it to Abraham as a gift by virtue of his promise, which is a reference to salvation as a free gift from God. So what was happening is these old, we're going to call them Pharisees or preachers, who were used to keeping people in bondage by the law. After Paul came in and taught them the liberty we have now in Christ by the Holy Spirit, after he came in to do that, what happened was these, when Paul left, these same old preachers started getting their people back by saying, you got to still observe the law. I mean, it's nice what Paul said, but you got to observe the law. And he was saying they brought you back under the bondage and eliminated Christ, because the Pharisees and those who are religious always hold people in bondage by saying, I am Abraham's seed. They always wanted to put themselves connected to this promise. But the promise wasn't given to say that that pastor would be over the flock. That's not how it went. It said that one would come to be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords over everyone, and that was Christ. It was pointing to Christ, but man is constantly trying to put themselves in position, like the Pope, quite honestly, who's saying they are the mediator between God and man. And some pastors do that. Some pastors are like, if you don't bless me, if you don't give to the church, if you don't serve in the church, then your blessings will be broken because you're out of order. And that's not God. That is not what he's saying. He's saying that unless you serve Christ and have the power of the Holy Spirit in your life, you cannot walk in God's promises, period. Absent of any man, from Abraham to Christ, from Christ to the Holy Spirit, from the Holy Spirit to us. That's the process. We individually. All right, so we're going to look at Romans chapter 6, verse 22. And I'm going to pull this up on the, let's see, I have it on my slide here. Like my little slides, you guys know that. And so I want to pull that up on the slide so you guys can see it really big. All right, so we see it here in Romans chapter 6, verse 23. Okay, it says, for the wages of sin is what? Death, right? All sin, any sin leads to death. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God. And look, we just read that. The free gift of God through Abraham, that is his remarkable, overwhelming gift of grace to believers, is eternal life. In who? Your pastor? The Pope? No, in Christ Jesus, our Lord. And that's where we can just rest today. I mean, that's where we can just rest today, knowing that God loves us so much that he sent Jesus to die for us, so that we wouldn't have to die in sin. He died in our place. Jesus died in our place, so that in Romans 6:23, we can see it says, for the wages of sin is death, right? We're no longer under the bondage of sin, but the free gift of God, which is salvation. That is his remarkable, overwhelming gift of grace to believers, is eternal life in Christ Jesus. What a powerful thing to know, what a powerful thing to have in our life, to know that God has already made provision for us to have this grace to walk in his favor and receive that blessing of Jesus Christ. That's his son. And that's what we want to know today and rest assured. Now, as we're climbing this holy mountain, as we're seeking to know God and make him known, we have to know truth about sin, because it is sin that separated us from God. Sin separated us from God. And unless you know what sin is, you will not be able to stand against it. If you don't know where it came from, you won't understand how to deal with it. And if you don't know what power you have over sin, you'll fall victim to it with the power to overcome it. Now, you know, that's a sad state of affairs when you have the power to overcome something and it overcomes you because you don't know you're strong enough to deal with that. So let's go ahead and jump into Romans chapter 6. And we're going to take a look at Romans chapter 3, verse 23 and 26. For all have sinned. That's everybody on the planet. Billy Graham. I don't care who they are on the planet. Anybody that's ever been born. This is says besides Christ. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. See, always pointing back to Christ, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. We receive Christ by faith. Why? Because we never saw Christ. We're reading the Bible. You have to receive by faith. The Bible says that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. And so by faith, we believe that Christ lived, that Christ died, that Christ was resurrected, and he's now seated on the right hand of the Father. By faith, we receive that gift of salvation. It is redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Verse 25, whom God put forward as propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. We're going to come back to the blood part. This was to show God's righteousness. I just got to stop right there and give him glory. Y'all just, I think we breeze past these scriptures like they just, we're reading a book. No, this right here. This was to show God's righteousness. God created us to live eternally on earth like Adam and Eve without sin, walking before him, fellowshipping with him. That was his desire. When Adam and Eve fell in the garden, God, because he's righteous, said that man has now sinned. I have to kick them out of the garden and they will surely die. And they were dying from that point on. Man started to die on the earth because they couldn't get to the tree of eternal life to eat the fruit and stay alive. It was God's desire for us to be that way. And God, because of his faithfulness, looked forward in time and said, everyone that will be born from Adam and Eve are destined to die unless I do something about it. And he told them in the garden, I'm going to fix what you just did. And because of his righteousness, he said, I'm going to send my son in time to die, to fix sin for all time and bring everyone back to me, all my children back to me. That's worthy of glory. We just thank you, Father, for that. This was to show God's righteousness because in his divine forbearance, he had passed over former sins, which people don't know. A lot of people don't know. From Adam to Noah, God didn't deal with sin. God winked. The Bible says God winked at sin because he knew man fell into sin, not because of choice, but because of inheritance through Adam. So he kind of gave like a little bit, he stepped back a little bit and things let it go. He let things go the way they were going without dealing with it. But when Noah came, he changed all of that. He made a new covenant through Noah and he started dealing with sin. All right, little side teaching right there. All right, so verse 26, it was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Our God is good. I mean, this is the kind of thing that as you study the word of God, you start seeing that, God is omniscient. He's all knowing. And he knew that he would have to make a plan so that he could recover us from sin. And he knew that in time we would be able to have the word of God, his word, to be able to do that. So Romans 3:23-26 should bring you comfort today so that you can see this. Now, what I want to do is I want to bring it up side by side. And this is just another little side teaching. It's a comparison. Now, when you study God's word, sometimes it's important to do a comparison in different versions of the Bible. All right. And so I'm going to bring up a side by side view so that you guys can see this, this comparison. All right. So here we go. I'm actually going to make this, bring this up large here. So hold a second. Let me move this around. All right. So here we go. All right. So we see the two versions, this English Standard Version and this Amplified Version. Those are the two versions we're looking at. Amplified does exactly what it does. It makes it bigger. It makes it more robust. But if you read the difference between the two, in the brackets on the Amplified Version, when you see these brackets, it says like in verse 22, Jew or Gentile, it gives you a deeper understanding of what the reference is. We're looking at 22 over here. It starts in 21 in the Romans, but it says, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe, right? And then you go to 22 in the Amplified, the righteousness of God comes through faith in Jesus Christ for all those, Jew or Gentile, who believe. You see how it magnifies that just a bit for you. So I want to encourage you. I usually read out of the English Standard Version. When I'm reading for myself, I read out of the King James. But when I teach out of the English Standard Version. But I want to encourage you to get, they have Bibles that are dual. So you get a Bible with King James and Amplified or English Standard and Amplified so that you can really drill down into the meaning of what it's saying. All right. So I'm not going to read through this because we just read that. But I do want you to know that as a Christian, as a Bible believer, this is what Christ said. Pick up your cross and follow me is what he said. And then he said, and learn of me. The only way you learn something is if you study it, not read. when most Christians will read the Bible. I read Romans chapter 3 today. But then when you turn around and say, great, did you study it? Tell me what you learned. They're like, oh, wow. We talked about, see, that day is over. We no longer are reading anything. We are studying God's word like our life depends on it, because it does, period. You need to know God's word so that you can do his will. So just want to make sure you guys got that. It is a technique that I use, and I want to make sure that you guys are flowing in that same gift. I was taught that by my past pastors as well. So it's not something I invented. So there you go. Give credit to whom credit is due. All right. So let's continue in Galatians chapter 3, verse 19. All right. And we need to make sure that, you know, as we are studying God's word, that we are understanding that God has a plan for our life, but we got to study his word to know what that is. You know, oftentimes people say, I don't hear God. God doesn't speak to me. Those people, even us, the question is, really, do you have a Bible? Because the Bible is God's word, and he's speaking in it to you, right? It's a love letter to us. From Genesis to Revelations, God is speaking to us so that he can put his word in our hearts, and he can speak through us to other people, just like I'm doing with you. I've been walking with Christ for 30 years, and I was a wreck 30 years ago, and I put in my heart that I was going to learn God's word more than anything on the planet. I was going to learn God's word, because when you think about it, only what you do for Christ lasts for all eternity. So if you want to study anything, I don't care how many bachelor degrees or master degrees or doctor degrees, all that stuff's going to burn up. It ain't meaning squat to God when you stand before him in eternity. What he cares about is how well you know his word, how well you lived it, and how you live for his son and glorify his name while you were alive. That's the only thing that's important when you step from this world into eternity. All right. So just want to encourage you, amplify your knowledge of God's word. It's really amazing. But it is the state of the church. They will tell you about their sports teams. They know the players. They know the stats. They will tell you about their favorite TV show, who's dating who, what happened last season, what's coming up. They will binge watch these shows. But you know what? They don't binge the Bible. And we need to. We need to, because God has told me that what needs to be done quickly, because time is growing short, which is why Arise Even was created, to help us climb the mountain and stay in God's presence. And look, I just want to say I'm thankful for everyone that's tuning in, everyone that's joined us this morning. I mean, this is, for us, the Arise Core team, this is the answer to our prayer, that more and more people would come and be a part of our fellowship, of our family, so that we can get into God's word just like we're doing now. And so we're going to get into Galatians 3:19 in the last few minutes of our study. I'm going to pull this up, my notes, so you can see it. All right. So let's continue with Galatians chapter 3, verse 19 through 29. Why then the law, what was its purpose? It was added after the promise to Abraham to reveal to people their guilt because of transgression. That is, to make people conscious of the sinfulness of sin. And the law was ordained through angels and delivered to Israel by the hand of the mediator, which was Moses, the mediator between God and Israel, to be in effect until the seed would come to whom the promise had been made. Now, the mediator, who is Christ, I mean, who was Moses at this time, or go-between in a transaction, is not needed for just one party, whereas God is only one and was the only one giving the promise to Abraham. But the law was a contract between two, God and Israel. Its validity depended on both. Is the law then contrary to the promise of God? Certainly not. For if a system of law had been given which could impart life, look at this, impart life, then righteousness, right standing with God, would actually have been based on law. But the scripture has imprisoned everyone, everything, the entire world under sin, so that the inheritance, the blessing of salvation, which was promised through faith in Jesus Christ, might be given to those who believe in him and acknowledge him as God's precious son. Wow. Verse 23. Now, before faith came, we were kept in custody under the law, perpetually imprisoned in preparation for the faith that was destined to be revealed, with the result that the law has become our tutor and our disciplinarian to guide us to Christ. The law was meant to bring people to Christ so that we may be justified, that is, declared free of guilt of sin and its penalty, and placed in right standing with God by faith. I'm going to read that again, because we hear that word and we sing the song, justified by faith, standing in his presence. Like, we hear that song and we say that word to be justified, but what does it mean? Justified means this, that is, declared free of guilt of sin and its penalty, and placed in right standing with God by faith. But now the faith has come, that faith has come, we are no longer under the control and authority of a tutor and a disciplinarian. Wow. That's so beautiful. We've been freed from sin. We've been freed from sin so that God can do his will in our life. We've been freed from sin so that God, who is the justifier of faith, can give us a better understanding of what it means to not be guilty of sin, which means that if you sin and when you sin, you don't have to stay in sin. See, in the past, without Christ, if you sinned, you felt like that was just you and you was just going to sin. Well, I done did it. If you were drinking and you got drunk, then you was like, well, I guess I'm an alcoholic. Well, I'm just going to keep on drinking every day. If you were having sex with somebody that wasn't your wife or your husband, then you were in fornication. And you were saying, I did it once. Well, I guess I'll continue. I done did it now. I'm going to keep. But see, you're no longer under the power of sin. You no longer will suffer the consequence of sin, which is death, because it says that God has freed you from the power of sin and delivered you and justified you and has taken the requirement of sin out of your life. So now, even if you sin, you can repent and turn back to God. That's a beautiful thing. If I ever heard anything in my life, because I know I was bad. I know I was a sinner, man. I'm just glad I didn't die in my sin. But to know that if I sin and when I sin, that all I have to do is repent, which means to turn away from and to have a remorse in your heart, a godly repentance in your heart for what was done, and to know that you're now free. You can get up and turn and go back to God, because God is always willing and ready to receive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So that's the desire of God. That's his heart. That's what he wants from us today, is to know that he loves us, and by faith we receive Christ from Abraham, and by receiving Christ, the law no longer has power over us, sin no longer has power over us, and we have been justified by faith in Christ to do God's will on the earth. And so we're going to stop right here, and we'll continue in Galatians 26, 27 tomorrow, but I just want to open it up and see if you guys have any questions at this time, so feel free to unmute yourselves. And if you don't have questions, if you have comments, we're open for that as well. So, does anybody have a question or a comment? And I just want to say, welcome, Victor, to the call, brother. All right, Evelyn, you have something?
Oh, no, I was just going to say wonderful teaching, wonderful teaching.
Oh, praise God. Praise God. Yes, this is, I was actually praying in prayer about where do we go from here? Yesterday we talked about, you know, meeting God on this holy mountain, the fact that we're called and understanding how he calls us. He called Moses. He called Solomon. He gave them assignments. And for us, a lot of us are trying to figure out, why am I here? Like, what's my purpose? Like, God, what do you want me to do? I mean, give me direction. And this is how we get that, by walking up this holy mountain. And with every step, we get closer to God. And as we get closer to God, a couple things happen. Sin starts to drop off. Our power starts to amplify. And our clarity of understanding, we start to hear his voice clearer. And so every day we show up here on this call, every day you study the Bible for yourself, every day you pray, praise, and worship God is a step up the holy mountain closer to God, and you're heading the right direction. I want to encourage you guys to do that, because God has a plan for your life. He has a plan for your year. And the question that you have to ask yourself, have to ask God, is, what do you want me to accomplish for you this year? When I ask God that question, I'm telling you guys, it's beautiful. This is us. You know, the Bible talks about how the angels ascended and descended on the earth. This was a moment where I saw clearly into heaven and understood wisdom from God, what man should be asking on the earth, because I have all kind of plans. You ask my sister. I have all kind of things I want to accomplish this year. I own two companies. I teach 4 Bible studies. I'm a part of the church. I'm assistant pastor at the church. Like, I got a lot that I'm doing, and I'm like going all for it. And then it dawned on me when I asked that question. I never asked God what his will was. I was just kind of believing God was, that I was flowing in God's will. And that's kind of a super spiritual thing. I've been walking in Christ 30 years, so you kind of feel like, I kind of know this, right? But this year, I asked him that question. What do you want me to accomplish for you this year? And when I asked him that question, it changed everything. I mean, put the brakes on everything, and God brought a rise up to me, and he was like, I want you to restore hope in my people and bring them to my holy mountain to meet with me. And I was like, well, tell me how to do it. And that's where Rise came from. That's where our core team came together. And that's what we built all this out, these lesson plans, so that we could teach you what God is saying to you. And as we started to walk up the mountain, just like I said yesterday, that's what we studied. I was really searching and praying by the Holy Spirit, where do we go from here? And he says, unless they understand sin, unless they know what sin is, they will, as they walk up the mountain, allow sin to creep back in. And before you know it, they won't even get on the call. They'll get used to going back out into the world, doing just like we looked at the Galatians, right? To their old ways, you know? And for you guys, I know a lot of you can't be on the call every Monday through Saturday. I understand that. But whether you want to call or not, you still should be praying. You still should be studying your word of God, the word of God, listen to praise and worship music or gospel music, whatever music you like, and connecting with God every day. Like, not Sunday. I mean, God forbid that you say, God, 6 days is mine. I give you Sunday, but I'm only giving you an hour. You better get it done in an hour because I got to eat. I got things. I got to watch my games coming on. You know what I'm saying? It's time out for all that, because you know what? Everybody's not going to heaven. There's a reason why the road that leads to destruction is wide and the road that leads to righteousness is narrow, because there's a few there be that find it, the word of God says. So you are, if you're called, you're also chosen to come up higher. God is calling you up higher, and I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to do that. So, all right. So at this point, I do want to open up again for any questions or comments or takeaways, anything that stood out to you today.
Hey, good morning, everybody. I would be remiss if I didn't say something. Pastor Stephen, I appreciate you. I really do. And I just wanted to throw out there, I really enjoyed it, but one of the things that kind of jumped out to me was when you said that to binge the Bible. Mm-hmm. You know, we binge Netflix and we, you know, binge Hulu and all that, but to binge the Bible. And I think that's my biggest takeaway from that, is to really get into the word, and enjoy the word, you know, as you said, study the word and really get into it. I do want to say though, just for, I don't know if it's good for the good of the group, I normally would be at work. I'm a teacher, but my son has COVID. So, He's good. You know, he's tired and a little fever. But other than that, Lord bless. You know, we're doing the medicine and all that good stuff. But I can't go to work because I direct contact. So sure. I have to quarantine for like the next 5 days. So, but like I said, we're good. So, you know, keep us in your prayers. But thank you for this morning.
All right. And Victor, what is your son's name?
Xavier.
Xavier. All right. So we add him to the prayer list. Core team, make sure you guys grab that name, Xavier. Yeah. Xavier is Victor's son. All right. COVID. All righty. Got it. Wrote that down. All right. And anybody that's watching this video at any time, make sure you pray for Victor and his family. He's a blessed brother, anointed. God has called him to reach the nations. He has a voice that God's going to use. So make sure you guys cover him in prayer, because that is a worthwhile thing to do with your life. Anyone else have a comment or want to share anything?
Hi, Pastor Stephen. I'm not sure what happened.
That's okay, Coco.
Yeah. You're all right. Just love that you came from the book of Galatians. Is one of my favorite actually, because I love the way when it in Galatians how it teaches, the experience and teaching of what for right for wrong, and they knew they was doing some things wrong. And I love that Paul, took the time to write these letters or to try to get them back on track. And when you talk about God's righteousness, that just comes out to me that our foundation is built on faith. We have to continue to stay in faith that we may not see it, but know that God is working, in our favor, because you always see the term, it may not come when you want it, but it's right on time. So I'm just excited what God is doing for each and every one of us, on the call collectively and individually, how he's getting ready to turn some things around. So I do encourage everyone to, just hold on, to the faith and know that God is working in your favor. So thank you, Pastor Stevens, for that word this morning.
Absolutely. I mean, we're thankful for everybody that's on the call, and we're thankful for what God's going to do in our life. I mean, this is just the beginning. We believe that the blessings that have been withheld from us for years, and I want you to see this in the spirit. There's literally like God was sending blessings to you, and there was a dam built and blocked it. And whether it was bricks that we put up there because of our own sin, our own laziness and not pressing into the things of God, in this season, that wall is going to come down. As you press into God, as you begin hearing his voice and doing what he says, and this is important because it's the small things that make the greatest impact. So don't take that for granted. If you hear a little whisper and it tells you to pick up that piece of trash, that point of obedience is important, because if you're faithful over little, he'll make you ruler over much. And from this point forward, all those things are tests of your obedience to his word. If he tells you to go and apologize for something you said to someone or something you did, or if he tells you to encourage someone, every time you hear the voice of God, and it won't be a loud voice. Matter of fact, I said, I believe it was yesterday. I was talking to the Holy Spirit, and his voice was so low. And I actually said this. I said, can you just speak up louder? Can you speak louder? I need to know it's you. Why are you whispering? I need to hear you. Right. But he don't. He doesn't do that. He will speak with a low tone and it'll be quick, and he won't even repeat himself. You got to know. The Bible says, my children know my voice, and another they will not follow. And so he's training us. The Holy Spirit is training us to have ears to hear. Right. A lot of people heard a thing, but a lot of people didn't hear it. Right. They didn't understand it. They didn't receive it. And so for us, the children of God, God is just saying in this season, the blessings that have been withheld for you will overtake you in this next season if you allow it. So but God wants you to get it. God wants us all to get it. And that's why we're here. And I'm thanking God for each one of you. Sister Evelyn, I call you the mother of the church. Do you have a word of inspiration for the people today?
I certainly do. And how many of you after yesterday changed your thinking from I got to do something to I get to?
Yeah, that was
a blessed
good.
Opportunity. Mm-hmm. Well, today it says, as you step out today, may angels lead you, may peace accompany you, may grace go before you, may love and light surround you. May kindness spread from you. May goodness and love follow you. May lessons teach you. May family support you. May friends encourage you. May God protect and bless you. And may your day be filled with love, peace, and joy.
Hallelujah. Oh, that's good. Thank you. That's good. Let's just give a hand for that. I just feel like applauding that one. That was good to my soul. And yes. I actually want you to read it again so we can get
yes,
it.
Because
I saw some people writing it down, but they were trying. And you're going,
okay.
Give it a second shot. Let's go.
As you step out today, may angels lead you. May peace accompany you. May grace go before you. May love and light surround you. May kindness spread from you. May goodness and love follow you. May lessons teach you. May family support you. May friends encourage you. May God protect and bless you. And may your day be filled with love, peace, and joy.
Amen. All right, so we're going to send that out to everybody that's on our email list. If you would like that, please put your email in the chat for us, and we will send that out for you and send you other information on us as well. So make sure you put your information, your email in the chat, and we will do that. All right, so we want to close on a high note, and I want to do testimony time. It is Testimony Tuesday is what it is. Testimony Tuesday. So I want you to think back to the goodness of God in your life. A time where he blessed you, rescued you, or answered your prayer and gave you the desires of your heart, and share just one nugget with the Arise family so we can go out on a high note. Anybody that wants to go can go ahead and share.
Stephen, while they're thinking, I'll go.
Okay.
With my book, A Winner in Spite Of, They say if you get 4 to 5 reviews, that's excellent. I've gotten 55, and Stephen did a wonderful one and got a letter from North Carolina Central University yesterday, which is where I graduated from. And I'm going to be the guest speaker in March. And they purchased 100 books, and it's going to be taught to the English comp class for freshmen.
Praise God.
So God is so awesome.
Whew. I'm glad we're doing testimony time. That's amazing.
Yes.
Oh, praise. And that's your first book.
That's my first book. And in the
Look
first two months of its release, the average book sells 250 in their shelf life. And this is not to brag, it's all because of God. Amen. But in the first three months, it had already sold 400 books.
God is good.
All the time.
I'm glad you're saying that, because see, when God calls you to something, he's calling you to people. And I say this all the time, your purpose is tied to other people. When you decided to be obedient to the Holy Spirit and write that book and get that thing done and go through the whole process, which I'm sure had its challenges, you actually were preparing something to bless other people. And the moment that it was created and ready to be birthed into the world, they were ready to buy it. Look at it. You breaking all kind of records. Folk calling you to speak at their college. They teaching your stuff in the college.
That's, God be the glory.
God is so good. This is what I'm saying about walking by faith. You don't know where God's going to take you. And it's not your business to know. He said, lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways, acknowledge him daily, and he will direct your path.
That's right.
It says paths. It has S on the end. Paths. So for you and for us, it's just a matter of being obedient with what he's given us today. If in your day he hasn't said nothing for you to do, then you just need to praise and worship him and study his word. And tomorrow, if he says something to do, do that. But we get so ahead of God. We want the big plan. Tell me the big plan. If from the beginning of Evelyn knowing that she was going to write a book, if she knew that all this was going to happen, it might have made her afraid. She might have been like, speaking at the college? Ooh, wait a minute. I don't know about that. You want me to do, they're going to buy how many books? Like, how? I'm going to go slow. Let me, I'm going to put out a PDF first. Put that online. No. You do what God tells you to do when he tells you to do it, and watch what he does because of your faith and your obedience. Obedience is better than sacrifice. So just be open to the Lord using you guys on that. With that, thank you, Evelyn. That's a good one right there. I love that.
That's a hallelujah.
That's a hallelujah. Praise the Lord. All right. Who wants to testify, give a testimony, or share a praise report next?
I'll go next.
All right.
This is
Keisha. Hey, Keisha.
Good morning. And at first I said, now my testimony can't top that, Miss Evelyn. So
we're not in competition, so yeah, it's all good.
But I'm gonna go ahead and testify anyway.
Praise the Lord.
So yesterday, as I was leaving out, I thought I was leaving out, my car wouldn't turn over at all, but I had my get to attitude. And I said, well, I get to find out what's going on with my car. And I get to take care of it. And I was surprised at myself that I didn't get frustrated. I said, okay, God, you got this. So anyway, the guy came out, AAA, and he tested it. And he showed it to me. He said, it's bad. It needs to be replaced. And at first, I was like, well, shoot, I think I got a lifetime warranty. But no, I don't even think that exists. My warranty had definitely expired. So went on AutoZone, and I thought the guy convinced me to get this battery that was $192. And even though I could not understand what he was saying, he said, all right, well, let me just go ahead out and test it. He went and looked at it, but he said, this battery is fine. Mechanic walked up. He said, well, did you check the terminals? He shook the terminals. He was like, oh, you just need the terminal fixed. And I didn't even have to do it right away. I said, well, how much is the terminal? He said, about $5-6. I said, well, let's do that. I said, how much you gonna charge me? He said, $20. I was like, all right, y'all, let's make this happen. And so I still have that battery. I can't believe it's still going. And I just bless God, because God is faithful all the time. And I say, I think about what he has done. And I say, I just can't bless him enough, because he keeps on showing up. And that's that abide. So anyway,
come on,
that's my
good
testimony.
Oh, that's and good.
Maybe a book one day. No.
Come on. Praise the Lord. Yeah, that is. And I'm glad God gave you the get to attitude, not I got to, because it's by faith. You know, the just shall live by faith, and that's what you was doing. Like, you know, and this is another good thing to understand, is that whatever happens in your life, if God is all powerful, and we know that He is, because He's omnipotent, if something happens in your life, God has allowed it. It's not your job to like it. It's not your job to fight it. It's your job just to flow through it, because whatever God's brought to you, He's going to bring you to, and give you the power to go through it. So you don't have to allow, you don't have to let a situation, I don't care what it is, whatever this, I used to drive 2 hours a day one way from work. I lived in Kinston, North Carolina, and I worked in Raleigh, North Carolina. So it was 4 hours a day driving just to get to work. And I was working at Radio One. And so I would drive 2 hours. My car broke down coming out of Raleigh, and I live 2 hours away, and it's hot, it's summertime. I'm like, God, you know what? I gotta roll my window down. I'm like, okay, I don't understand why you let my car break down so far away from home. And I was sitting there, I was like, oh, I got AAA. I called AAA. Took them almost an hour to get to me. I was like, Lord Jesus, you got me baking in the car. I said, all right, well, I mean, if this is where I'm supposed to be, you have a purpose for it. Got in the truck with the guy, and guess what? He needed to know about Jesus. I talked to him about Jesus all the way home. I had a whole hour to talk to him. So whatever happens in your life, there's a purpose. You know, there's a song we used to sing, if you can use anything, Lord, you can use me. And I remember I used to sing that with all my heart. You better be careful what you say out your mouth, because you never know what position God's going to put you in to be used by Him. You know, we always thinking about, you know, the blessings that come from the Lord, but sometimes that comes through tribulation. He that endures temptation shall be blessed. Sometimes God will allow things to happen in your life to strengthen you so that you can get blessed. Like Job, double portion, double for his trouble, right? So, but anyway, anything that happens in your life, be at peace. You know what? Do like Jesus. Storm come up, say, storm, calm down. Peace, be still. And the people around you are like, you're not mad? You're not upset? You're not getting a lawyer? Like, no, my father ain't telling me to do none of that. I'm just going to be at peace. That's what I'm going to be. All right? So, praise the Lord. All right. So, and a good study for you guys is the Beatitudes, because that recenters you in the things that a righteous person does before God. And it pleases God for us to live in those attitudes, because those are the attitudes of Christ. Let this mind be in you that's also in Christ Jesus, right? Because the thoughts of the righteous are right. And that's how we should be. All right. So anybody else have a testimony they want to share or a praise report on Testimony Tuesday?
I'll just share this with you really quick, Pastor Stevens. Just, you know, just because of what you just said about, you know, how the Lord would do things sometimes, you know, for you to help someone else. And I'll make this really quick, but it took me back to when I went into the hospital, and I'm being real transparent here, went into the hospital to have a hysterectomy. Well, once I woke up, I couldn't walk. I could not walk. They didn't know what happened. No one knows what happened. So I ended up staying in the hospital, training just to learn how to walk again for 3 months. 3 months. And I kept asking the Lord why, because, you know, I had things to do. I got to sing. I got to be here. I got to be there. But the Lord shut all of that down. And I finally realized what it was for, Pastor Stevens. The roommate that I had in the rehabilitation center was an atheist. By the time I left, and I'm going to try not to get excited. By the time we left, she was saved, knew the Lord, because she was in there in the hospital a long time before I even got there with a brain aneurysm. I wanted to tell you this morning, I spoke to her yesterday. She's fine. She's back out in the country riding her horses and different things. But the Lord put me in that place, not for her, to speak in her, and I could not figure it out. But sometimes, just to encourage someone, you know, you don't know why, but trust me, like you said, Pastor Stevens, it's a reason why God put you in that particular, in that situation, and it was for her. So I just want to, you know, put that out there as a praise break, because He, for her, and when I came home, I just got up one day and started walking.
Look at God.
You understand? I just got up one day and started walking. So I just said to God, I stopped asking the question why, and just say, Lord, continue to use me, you know, for your glory. So I'll take that not walking for 3 to 4 months for someone's life to know the Lord.
Praise God.
That's my praise report.
That's good. And, you know, I'm going to tell you something. That lady is very important. She, You know, Billy Graham's mother didn't know that her son would do all that he did. Whoever ministers to her, for her to be Christian when Billy was born,
yeah,
was used like you were used that day with that lady. You have no clue what that lady is going to do for God in the world, who yes. she's going to touch, and what's going to come through her. And God had to send you. It was like an emergency. He had to get you in there. And this is another thing. The Bible says what Satan meant for evil, God will turn around for good. Mm-hmm. So the doctors might have made a mistake, but God was like, "Why are you in here? There's an assignment." Right. So praise the Lord. God, we give you glory for that. All right. So let's go ahead and close in prayer. And whoever's led to pray for us today, you can go ahead and pray, and we'll close with that.
Father, we just thank you, God, today for this wonderful Bible study that you have allowed for all of us to be a part of. God, we ask you to continue to bless each and every one of us, Father, that we may continue to do your will, not only being hearers of the words, but being doers of the word, God. We know that the faith, God, is just like a mustard seed, and we want to have that faith, God, to continue to believe and trust in you, God. We thank you for Pastor Stephen and the ministry of what he's doing, you know, teaching and preaching the word. The Bible says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations." And we thank God for Pastor Stevens this morning. Continue to bless us. Continue to guide us, God. Continue to give us that spirit to not to want to have to go, but go get what you want us to get, Father, in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you and we love you. This is our prayer this morning, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
In Jesus' name, praise God. Thank each one of you guys for joining the call today. Please come back tomorrow. Tell somebody about the Bible study and what it has done for you, and invite them into the family, the Arise family. We're thankful for that. Just copy the link that you have and send it to them. Feel free to post. We'd love posts. You can actually go to my profile on Facebook and share my posts if you don't like typing and putting all that together. And you can share my posts as well to get to more people. Look, I want to encourage each one of you that God has a purpose for your life, and that he's going to reveal to you that by you hearing his word and hearing his voice on a daily basis. So have ears to hear each day and know that the best is yet to come, especially for the children of God. So you should get excited about that and be encouraged. If you have any questions, you can reach me directly. You can call me. You guys have my information. So I look forward to seeing you guys tomorrow. We're going to continue on sin, and we're going to transition to something very special right after that. So hopefully you guys will show up tomorrow, and we will talk to you and see you then. All right. God bless. Have a good one.
I sent that to you, Stephen. Pastor Stephen.
Okay, great. Yeah, I saw it come. Look, Evelyn was joking. She was like, right when I said that, she was putting that thing together, and she said it right to me on my phone. So I'm going to get that out to those who put their emails in. Oh, this is a lot. If anybody else wants to receive what Evelyn, the inspiration Evelyn gave us, I have two people that want that. If anybody else wants that, just put your email in so I can know who to send it directly to. And then that will be in the chat, and I will be able to get that. All right, you guys, look, have a blessed week. And we will see you tomorrow. All right. God bless. Have a good one.
God bless.
All right.